are going to study text tonight dealing with the concept of conflict. Not really the reconciliation part, but different types of conflict. Good conflict and bad conflict. Because Jews loves to argue, right? Yes, we loves arguing. Before we get into tonight's, though, I wanted to just sort of reflect on an email that I received after the last class and discuss it for a little bit. Remember, we said last time that we want to suspend reality and suspend literal meanings of things, and we want to just be able to sort of say things and think things that are totally nonsensical. When we're studying this stuff, because who wants to spend the whole class trying to, you know, be idiosyncratic about stuff or try to look at it through the lens of someone living in 2017 with all the technology? Like, you could totally, in the middle of our talk tonight, you know, Google something and then challenge me on it. Like, I'm going to take it personally because I have anything to do with the writing of this stuff, which I don't, by the way. You know, we're going to just sort of let it go, let it hang, be cool. And if there are things, as I said, you know, last week, as opposed to being sort of interactive like Torah study, I'll present as much as I can. And then when it's time to come up for breath, then we'll have some questions at certain times. So last time, a couple of you said, oh, I think I get it. And then one person actually sent me lyrics, which totally made sense. And because, you know, music is its own way of expressing God, and has its own way of expressing God. And this person said that they thought that they got it and just had this reflection. This is on the idea of, if you look at your sefirot again, I thought it would be easier for you to hold it this week. Last week, or 2 weeks ago, we talked about chesed and givurah, and that general concept in the Zohar, that we are bringing together aspects of God's, elements of God's being, or aspects of God's character, closer together. When we get them closer together, then we get closer to God. When we tear them apart, we're going to learn tonight, when we tear them apart, like when we're part of tearing them apart, we actually bring in hell. We actually make hell on earth, so to speak. And so we're going to talk about that other element of it as well. So this person said, when one understands that Tiferet is comprised of both chesed and gevurah, remember we talked about both aspects of love, pain, suffering, difficulty, challenge, and then that sort of, you know, warmer love, or when we talked about the God who sits in the chair of compassion, in addition to God sitting in a different chair of judgment, coming together, that when one understands that this creates the light that becomes in your soul consummate love, then one only has to define what this means to yourself. In this person's model, it was about reestablishing good when good or bad happens, with God's help, Tiferet will rebalance and help us to move forward. I would only clarify, it's not about moving forward, it's about moving up the sefirot, right? You can't start at the keter, crown. You start at the bottom. Actually, you start below the bottom, to be honest. And then for us, it's about progress up, not progress forward. Because everything's got progress, forward movement in it. This is about getting closer to heaven, right? They believed in their worldview, and many of us do too, heaven's up here, we're down here, hell's down here below us. So it's about going up, it's a ladder. And you can look at it about moving forward, but it's about moving up. When we're called to the Torah, it's aliyah, we're called to an aliyah, we go up because we're doing a holy act. You can rebalance and move forward. If you don't rebalance, experience this Tiferet, you will not function as a complete person. That's very true in a Kabbalistic sense, but you actually will continue to function, but there won't be any ladder. In other words, you'll be trying to live your life. What's the saying, someone who translated the Woman of Valor said that this woman is so great because she is not in the world, she is of the world. Actually, I said this the other day at a funeral Tuesday, about this woman who the daughter wrote these beautiful words about, and I got to read them for her because she didn't want to read them. And I used that word. It's Rami Shapiro's translation. She's not in the world, like we're all in the world, but she's of the world. So yes, you will not be integrated. If you can't do this, you won't be integrated into not just the world, but in the universe, but God. Like, you won't know God. Okay, so, and then he used an example from something, but I just wanted to respond that that's getting that first level of meaning and understanding. And by first level, I don't mean that like there's a second and a third level. It's just, it's the integration, it's different. People who say bad things happen, evil happens, I've had bad luck, therefore God doesn't exist, they just don't get it. They don't get this. Or, oh, all these good things happen to me. It's like the football player who gets on one knee and thanks God after the touchdown. Like, God cares that you scored a touchdown because God doesn't care. That's just like the definition of narcissistic, oh, something good happened, praise God. Like, that's just for them, and for many of us, I think. God doesn't care that you scored a touchdown or won an Oscar. It just doesn't care. But God cares that you experience beauty, grandeur, and this word, chesed, the idea of compassion and passion and that feeling. And by the way, that's a very private thing. It's antithetical to go and thank God after the touchdown to this idea, because it's a very personal thing. It's inside your kishkas. So thank you for the emails, and I'll do that next time too if we have any other questions that come up. All right, so remember last time we talked about how the Kabbalah is, the Zohar is a commentary at the end of the day. It's a commentary on the Torah. And so they intersperse these verses from Torah. And randomly, just like traditional rabbinics, randomly will select a verse or part of a verse, take it out of context and throw it in because it's helping to make a point, because this is all about the bringing together of the oral tradition and the written tradition. The Bible, we remember the Bible is what we call the written law given by word to Moses by God at Mount Sinai. The oral law was also given to Moses at Mount Sinai. That's the Talmud, the Gemara, and the Mishnah. That's this. These are the concepts, ideas, arguments, discussions, and conversations about the Torah. Those were also given to Moses at Sinai, and when we have arguments about Bible, or as we're going to see in a second, they're going to insert some Bible text, and then they're going to discuss, talk amongst yourselves, that they are doing what is called, does anyone know what an argument that is within the tradition, using the tradition within the tradition to explain the tradition, that kind of argument is called in Hebrew? If I say the word, some of you will nod and remember. It's called a machloket. Have you heard this word, machloket? A machloket is an argument for the sake of heaven, right? I want to know God better. I want to understand God better. I want to understand God's will better. I'm in the Talmud. The most famous, who we're going to talk about later, are Rabbi Hillel and Rabbi Shammai. Or the school, Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel, in the Midrash and in the Talmud, these are the two schools of thought. And what's interesting is Hillel typically wins the day in these arguments, but Shammai is never referred to as wrong. Okay? It's about conflicting truths, serving the purpose of really illuminating the light of God for the sake of heaven, we call it L'shem Shammayim. So machloket is the word, and that is a word worthy of looking up and Googling and learning about, because in Judaism, machloket is, by the way, misunderstood, because a lot of people think that the arguments that they're having are machlokets, and they're not. They're just arguments. And so tonight, we're going to discuss the difference between just an argument and a machloket. And it's going to be apropos just turn the TV on, apropos what we see in society right now. Last time I said go out into your world and insert this idea of Tiferet into your week. Now I'm going to ask you tonight, when you leave this world, to go out into that world and integrate, if you can, or look for times, possible times to integrate the idea of conflict and understand, are you part of the problem or are you acting with solutions to the problem? And I think that that will hopefully help you look at things a little bit differently. And if you're really uncomfortable with it, you'll come back next week and you'll say, oh, I went out and I'm part of the problem, hee hee hee. But what I'm saying is, yes, we're all part of the problem. No one's off the hook. I mean, come on, if we were off the hook, you know, I'd be probably a lot less negative judgmental, all those things, right? So we all do conflict for the sake of conflict. We all have arguments for the sake of arguing. And when you, you know, look at what's going on in the world, all these people showing up to all these meetings and screaming at the top of their lungs, these are not machlokets. These are just screaming for the sake of screaming. And it has nothing to do with politics. It has to do with how disturbed people are. Okay. No, it really has to do with the lack of Tiferet and the lack of knowledge that your words, how you have an argument, how you present a conflict, and how you address it can either bring God closer and us closer to God or create space, right? If this is all about bringing these together and closer so that we can get access to God, splitting them apart and tearing them apart, actually, we'll see in a second, use this image, separating Chod from Netzach, pushing Yesod aside, pushing Chesed, and we can't get to these middle things, which are really important to us, if they're totally getting separated on the ends, like we're too much Chesed and not enough Gevurah, that actually in the Kabbalah, in the Zohar, creates space, and in that space, hell comes up. And hell on earth, that's what happens. We actually open up room for ultimate hell. For the Kabbalah, you know, a lot of Jews don't believe that Jews believe in hell. They're fine, but we do. And it's called Gehinom, and we'll look at it in a second, or Gehenna. And what do they mean by that? Oh, it's not what the Christians... No, it is. It's hellfire, damnation, punishment in 14th century Spain. That's what they mean. Okay? So, we're going to have now this random conversation. I'm going to read a tiny bit in the Aramaic and then translate it. But before I do that, the topic is of this conflict, or at least that they're going to use symbolically, are the first 3 days of creation. All right, so what happens at the beginning of creation? What do you think is the moment that creation begins? I'm going to read to you the first three verses of Torah, okay? And I want you to think about, when does creation begin? Breshit bara Elohim et shamayim ve'et ha'aretz. When God created the world, I'm sorry, when God created the heavens and the earth, v'ha'aretz hayita tohu v'vohu, and the earth, or the land, was void and chaotic, v'choshech al p'nei tahom, and there was darkness on the face of the water, of the tahom, of the depths, which means the water. V'ruach Elohim merachefet al p'nei amayim, and the wind of God merachefet blew on the face of the water, like white caps, the whole thing. V'yomer Elohim yihi or v'yihi or. Then God said, there should be light. He or, make there be light, and there was light. Vayar Elohim et ha'or, and God looked at the or, at the light. Ki tov, and it was good, or that it was good. Ve'yavdel Elohim ben ha'or uven ha'choshech. And God understood or saw the difference between dark and light. Remember, it started out tohu v'vohu, chaotic and sort of void, and then there was light, and God could tell. There was a contrast between light and dark. Vayikra Elohim la'or. God called the or, the light, yom, v'lachoshech kara laila. God called the dark, the light day and the dark night. Ve'erev ve'yivoker yom echad. And there was evening and there was morning, first day. So what do you think was the moment of creation? Bereshit. Why? So Bereshit, we translate typically as in the beginning. Modern translations are trying to get really literal. And so they say, when God began. Does it matter? Yes and no. But why do you think Bereshit?
Because that's when it will start, the first word, Bereshit.
So creation begins with the word Bereshit because?
That's not creation of God, actually.
What? Oh, okay. So in your interpretation, Bereshit includes not only the beginning of creation, but the beginning of God. So in that moment, both God and...
For us.
Okay.
God is always there. For us, that was the beginning.
Okay. Someone else? When was the beginning? Or when did creation start? Yeah, Lance. And then Steve. Lance? When God saw light, and maybe, Steve, you were going to say the same thing?
Yeah, Big Bang.
Oh, Big Bang. The darkness, and then there was light.
The vessel
okay. Break. What?
The vessel break.
There's nothing in here about the vessel. So you're doing what we all do, and you're gonna project what you already know about Zohar, and we talked about last week, Tzimtzum, into this. Use just the words here. I'm with you, Omar. Totally with you. You're not wrong. But for the purposes of these words, when did it begin in this story? When did creation start? Gail?
The chaos.
The chaos. It started in the chaos. Okay? Anyone else want to guess? Lori, go. Right. So, like I said to Omar, in the text, we don't have that indication that God was already there. We just have this Bereshit bara Elohim. So, while what you and Sam very much can piggyback on each other, it's not confusing because you know enough other texts to say, oh, wait a second, this was before creation. There was a whole other thing going on that is called God. And right, but that's projection. We're putting something else into the text that's not here, which is totally Jewish, totally fine, and totally good. But in order to study, my point that I try to make is that it's confusing. We don't know when the moment of creation starts based on the verses. You get verses and chapter and verses about this beginning, Bereshit word, in not only in the Zohar, but in the commentaries, in the rabbinic commentaries, because everybody is curious as to what that means. There is an argument to be made that... The light and specifically the difference or distinction between the mavdil, bein yom uvein laila, the distinction between the light and the darkness was really when creation started. But when we talked about last week and now Omar and Laura, we can go back to going off the page, so to speak. When we talked last week, we talked about how the supernal light, which is that light that existed before creation, that was then contained in the vessel, exploded. So God needed to contract in order to expand, right? God needed to contract in order for there to be a creation. When that happens and all of these things are driven apart, remember, the goal of the Kabbalah, the goal of the Zohar, is to teach us ways to bring it back together. To bring all those pieces, all those shards, especially these divine emanations, back together. To bring chesed together with givurah so that we can have teferet. And so for the Zohar, creation was actually started through pure thought. God's pure thought, ideas. And remember, I'm limited because I'm using human language, English in particular, to explain supernal light. But that supernal light, i.e. the light of God, and you said Big Bang, was there before the Big Bang. In other words, if it's going to be contracted into dark and then blows up again into light, and then all this stuff happens and creation happens, there is, if you can see it in the text or not, a very violent cycle. There is light and there is dark and there is chaos. And there are all these different descriptors about how violent, how unrealistically violent, supernal, massive, seismic shifting. By the way, in Jewish belief, remember, God is perfect. God is the idea of perfect, always will be perfect. But as soon as these processes begin of supernal light and dark and explosions and tohu vavohu, as Gail pointed out, and all this other stuff, as soon as that all starts, in a sense, God loses some control over what's going to happen because it's not filled with God's light purely anymore. Right? It becomes our job to bring that light and darkness together. So that's day one. And I can understand if that doesn't totally make sense. I hope it does in a second. Day two is Vayomer Elohim Yehi Rakia Betoch HaMayim. God says, let there be an expanse in the water. Vayehi Mavdil Ben Mayim LaMayim. And let the water be separate from the water. Vayaas Elohim Et HaRakia. And God made this expanse, this rakia, between mayim, asher mitachat l'rakia uvein hamayim asher me'al l'rakia ve'yehi chen. God takes this, again, very violent, takes this, there's a lot of breaking up to bring it back together, right? I talked about contraction in order to expand, darkness in order for there to be light, water. Big, big, big piles of water. If anyone's ever been in the ocean before, you know how violent the water can be. Getting pulled apart, and God is doing all of this. God then, Vayikra Elohim Lerakia Shamayim. God calls one of the piles of water separated, atmosphere, clouds, heaven, whatever you want to call it, and the other one God calls the ocean or the sea, or right, so there's water above, water below, atmosphere, clouds, rainy things, that was really profound, and then water, ocean, right? So those are separate, and God says, and there was evening and there was morning the second day. By the way, there's no time yet. We haven't had a sun or a moon yet. What the Zohar is going to try to do, by the way, in this argument, in this machloket, in the two examples of the conflict over this, which has actually nothing to do with this, is they are going to try to say something was really still out of sync. There was so much separation, so much disorder and chaos. You got the heaven and the earth, you've got the expanse above and the expanse of water below, that there needed to be something created, something that would happen as part of creation to balance it, because we're still not balanced yet. We have Erev and Voker, we have morning and night, but you think of night and morning in a way that's very, very different than what creation does, because they haven't had a sun and a moon yet. There's no sun or moon. Oh! Great. By the way, for those of us who believe in evolution, who believe that the world is billions of years old, we use this text as a proof text for saying there was no time yet. So the first 2 days of creation could have taken as long as we want to say that they took. Okay? Now God says, Elohim, Yikvu hamayim mitachat hashamayim el makom echad, God said, let the waters beneath the sky all go into one place. so that dry ground can be seen, so that we can see dry ground. Vayihichen, and there it was. Why? God had the thought. This is what it should look like. Boom, that's what it looked like. So instead of chaotic water swirling above and chaotic water swirling below, God starts to organize the chaos a little bit, right? We went from contraction to expansion, from dark to light, from these weird meteorological things that weren't even meteorological because they were chaotic, and now God's saying, okay. God starts to actually bring things together a little bit and creates sea, right? God called the dry ground earth and called the collected waters the seas, and God saw that it was good. So that's all I'm going to do from creation. Keep in mind, contraction, expansion, the light going into a vessel and the world becoming dark and then blowing up and becoming light, but chaotic light. Water flying all over the place without any form to it. Nothing's formed yet. And then finally putting some form to it. Okay, land and ocean. Firmament, we like to use that word. It's very biblical. And now let's go to the text of the Zohar. So we are reading from chapters 17a and b. Any questions about the first 2.5 days of creation? Yes.
So how
come God didn't do it all at one time? The text is going to help us understand process. And process, we talked about this a tiny bit last week. God is a progressive God, right? God has ideas, and those ideas take form, and they are pure and perfect and beautiful in ways that we cannot understand. And then God blows the whole thing up and puts it back together, and then asks us eventually to be partners in helping God put it back together. So we don't know is the easy answer why God decides to not just do it. Do it all. One fell swoop. On the other hand, the answer is God did do it all in one fell swoop in this idea, in this thought, in this pure thought. The reshitiness, as we call it, the reshitness is that thought. And it all was done in thought. But time, space, and God are unrelated. Not only in the mind of the Zohar, but in the mind of the mystics in general. Just because God thinks something doesn't mean that it happens immediately. That's what we talk about fate sometimes. Just because we are in that Gevura place, you know, the dark place, the evil place, the place where we feel punished, doesn't mean that there isn't good yet to come. We want immediate gratification. Immediate. We want it now. God does not work that way. Moses does not get to enter the promised land, remember. He leads the people for 40 years. He doesn't get to enter the land. What was the point? What a terrible, oh God, what a terrible punishment. Like, God is like a sadist in that story, right? Poor Moses, poor guy. It's like, you know, retiring and dying on the same day. You don't get to enjoy your pension. Like, it's like, oh my, this God is cruel. No. Think about this for a second. Yes, Moses does basically die on the day of his retirement and doesn't get to see the promised land. This is in 3,300 years ago. So that was very sad for Moses, I'm sure. We're still talking about Moses today. Moses' afterlife, his post-death meaning and purpose is he is the rabbi of all rabbis forevermore for the Jewish people. So his life meant so much more than leading the Israelites out of Egypt. Not just symbolically, but literally, we're still talking about him. So what we think within time and space, as we want it now and whatever, God doesn't work that way. And so if God contracts and expands, if there's this dark and then there's this light, who are we to say, well, why wasn't it done right away? Well, it's a fair question. But I think that other than saying I don't know the answer could be, might be, that things are created, or creation is expanded in due time in a way that we don't see it, or we may not see it, and then it happens, right? Or it doesn't happen in our lifetime. Remember, God defies time and space. So it's a very fair question. It's a very good question. We could do a whole class on it. And the Zohar does, by the way, very much ask that question, Michael, about why not just have the Big Bang, but have it all set, you know? It's sort of like, for those of you who cook briskets slow, low temperature over a long time, it's much better than putting it in the microwave and getting it done as fast as possible. That would be a terrible brisket. So yes, we should always make analogies to food. Any other questions, quickly?
Yes.
Yeah, please. Right, so why is God, or why is the Torah using Erev and Voker, or Boker, morning, what we translate as morning and evening, if there's no moon to, you know, symbolize the evening and Shemesh, or sun? It's another great question. But if God defies time and space, the word Erev and Shemesh, or sun and dark, or Yom and Erev are meaningless. So in other words, I think that whoever wrote these words and are telling the story of creation, they have to use some context that people will understand. And I think it's not just a cheap answer. I think it's probably not the deepest answer. I'm sure there are many more answers, but there has to be language to specify the meaning of what's going on. And so they do use the words Boker and Lila. But in an existence or a universe or a time when there is no time in space in the way that we account it, these are words that are easier for us to grasp onto, at least. But it doesn't tell us that there was a 24-hour cycle. It doesn't tell us if there was a sun and a moon, as you pointed out. And it certainly doesn't tell us what they meant. We can only know what they mean now, as opposed to what they meant in the context of the story. What?
Phase one.
Beta test one, or
phase one, phase three.
Okay, here we go. So the Zohar says the following. I want everyone to have this sheet ready. I kept it separate so that you can look at it. And we're going to go a little bit back to Gevurah and Chesed and to Tiferet. So Moses in... someone read so I can take a sip of my beverage. Someone read this paragraph, even if it doesn't make any sense.
Moses.
Thank you, Jonathan.
Moses, in his wisdom, pondered over this and drew a lesson from the work of creation. In the work of creation, there was...
I'm sorry.
Sure.
Pondered over what? Okay, this is a story, a midrash, a Zohar commentary on Korach. Korach is the guy who is famous for his rebellion that he forms against Moses and Aaron during the Israelites' wandering. Korach represents sort of the bad conflict, right? He's a lot of, and Korach questions in the text, in the Torah, Moses and Aaron's authority, but really is questioning God's authority. And ultimately, the ground opens up and swallows Korach and all of his minions, okay? Little context there, little clue, little hint. Okay, go.
Moses, in his wisdom, pondered over this and drew a lesson from the work of creation. In the work of creation, there was an antagonism of the left against the right, and the division between them allowed
Gehinom
to emerge and fasten itself to the left.
Okay, stop right there. If we ask, what is Gehinom, or do Jews believe in hell, you may have a variety of answers. Many Jews think that we don't believe in hell. Like, we don't believe in that eternal damnation and hellfire place. The Zohar writers did, and we do. Now, you don't have to, by the way. I'm not going to take points off. for not believing in hell, but we do. And that is where evil souls reside. Evil like the Pharaoh, hardened heart, couldn't, people who can never get past evil. That's where their souls reside. Okay, go. Oh, sorry, I said go too soon. So look at your sheet. So we've got the human body form here for this particular interpretation of the Sephirot. And this is saying that in the text that there was a, in the work of creation, there was an antagonism of left against the right. And in our story, it's going to be this Gevurah, judgmental God, the God of judgment, and chesed, and kindness. And just like we, can someone close the inside doors? Because the kids are coming out for break and it's going to get noisy out there. Just like we believe that the right side, the right hand is dominant, so too they believe that the right side, and you'll notice the right side are, as we discussed last week, chesed is the nice part of the Tiferet equation. It is the love. It is, what did we call it last week, 2 weeks ago? What kind of love?
Compassion.
We talked about this? What? Consummate love. Consummate love is Tiferet, right? The right side of consummate love is compassion. Love of God, that God, you know, all that good stuff. So this is saying that in the work of creation, there was this antagonism. There was this push-pull between the left against the right, and the division between them allowed for hell to emerge and to fasten itself to the left. Does anyone want to take a guess as to what that means? Why would hell... Okay, so do you understand what's happening? You've got your... Forget about Tiferet for a second. You've got your... I have to do it this way. Okay, you've got your right, which is Chesed, and your left, which is Gevurah. Now, these are being split apart in an argument that is not for the sake of heaven, that is not a machloket, where there is conflict for the sake of conflict, where you're dealing with an evil force. Korach is the example that we're going to use in this particular piece. These things split. And when they get further apart from each other, dark forces, Gehinom, fills in that space in between them, not Tiferet. Tiferet doesn't, it's not even on the body anymore because you've opened up this division. It's like, here it is, it's coming up, it's actually getting pushed up into this space, okay? He's got some self-doubt, did you say? Self-doubt, critical of himself, like something I'm doing isn't getting through here. What if I said it's this simple, that Moses recognizes in Korach's rebellion that Korach is so bad, so evil, so much creating conflict for no reason, and he can't do anything about it. He can't fix it. What if the conflict is for Moses? Right, Moses isn't perfect. We all know this. And Moses is a very humble guy. We know this too, both in the text and out. Hasn't anyone ever felt when they're dealing with someone who actually they may have loved, or they may have respected, or they may have even been in business with, or even someone who is your brother or your sister, at the moment that you realize that they are so bad, that there is no good, not just in relation to you, because you know something about them that they don't know about themselves, isn't it really awful to know there's nothing you can do about it? By the way, how long does it take us to get to the place where we can finally say, there's nothing I can do about it? Some people spend their lifetime because they're so good or want good. They want machloket. They want, you know, the conflict to be for the sake of heaven. That it takes them forever just to get to the point of saying, there's no good in this person. I used to say to counselors at camp when we were doing training back in the late 80s, early 90s, when I was younger, and I would say, you know, there's no such thing as a bad camper. And then, without going into details, I had an experience that made me understand that that was wrong. There is such a thing as a bad camper. There is such a thing as a bad child. There is. I'm not going to get into the reasons why or what the parents did or didn't do, right? These are all psychologically valid reasons for kids to become bad kids. But I realized there isn't such a thing anymore, and that was really, really sad. And so Moses is going to go to this creation story because he's feeling this hell. He's feeling it come up, according to the Zohar. So the central column, the third day, he's going to use this idea of chaos, of light and dark, and distinguishing between light and dark. It's hard to get to a place where you can distinguish between good and evil, especially pure evil, right? Most of us are good. But we're not pure good, but we're working on it, right? But evil people can't even work on it. They can't even work on it. And Moses, second day comes, and we've got this tearing of water and water, and there's water, and there's this, and you know, it's all water, and it's all messy. And then the third day comes, and Moses says, it intervened, or the Zohar says, this third day, which is going to be the separation, the beginning of the organization, punchline, creation, in some respects, in some regards, doesn't start until the third day. Because there's chaos until the third day. There's, I guess you could call it somewhat organized chaos, because you do have light and you do have dark and you do have water and water, but it's not really happening yet. It's not formed yet. And this goes back to your question, Michael. Maybe it's about stretching it out, the creation, to teach us about process and to teach us about patience and to teach us about how to get out of the chaos. And Moses looks and says, it intervened and allayed the discord between the two sides, meaning it started to bring them back together. So the Gehinnom descended. It went back down. When we bring these things together and Tiferet starts to come, we're pushing down. We're subduing. Wow. It comes up every now and then, right, at this time, and it pushes the hell away. One of the things that we have to do for that to happen is we have to be able to identify it, the evil and all that stuff. And the left became absorbed in the right. The Gevurah now comes closer to the Chesed, and there was peace over all. God begins creation, or begins putting the pieces back together. No pun intended, it's just a wordplay with the other piece. Piecing the world back together on day three by having some land and putting the water in its place, so to speak. And that is the analogy that Zohar is going to make. You've got day one, day two, and day three. You've got contraction, expansion, dark, light, and then settled, it settles. Everything settles down on day three. And you get Tiferet. Yeah?
You don't think you know what you're talking about? I don't even know if I have a question.
Then we're in the same place. Look, that's the beauty of studying this stuff. And I told you guys a couple weeks ago when we started, this is the first time I'm doing it. I have no idea what I'm doing.
I have no idea what I'm asking.
Good. So join the club.
Mm-hmm. And the Gehinnom, the evil,
the hell.
The hell.
Let's call it what it is.
He doesn't understand. Is he aware that it exists? Does Moses have that awareness that it exists?
Go ahead.
And the fact that it's taking over the left side, the kindness. Like, who are you? Oh, that somebody actually said.
He's astonished. It's a great segue question to the next part, because now we're going to take the analogy. The Zohar is going to take this analogy of this argument that Moses is having within himself, and they're going to apply it to the story of Korach. So you're actually asking a question that is projecting, or at least intuiting, that we're going to now go and take the analogy and apply it to the story. But one more question, and then it's 8:05. I want to take a 5 to 7 minute break so everyone can go potty, and then we'll come back and answer that question that you actually made a lot of sense asking. Yes. One more, and then, Lori, I'll get you after the break. Go ahead.
We're all created in the image of God.
Mm-hmm.
How can someone be purely evil?
Oh, if we're all created in the image of God, how can someone be created evil? Okay. That's a great question. It can obviously have its own class, just on evil. I promised you 2 weeks ago that we were going to learn evil from the Zohar perspective. So I'm going to answer it next week or the last class. I haven't decided which one. When God separates into these spherot, when God contracts and expands, they take on lives of their own in some senses. And when they take on lives of their own, in other words, when the creation is created, remember, from this idea of perfection, perfect God, all this stuff, some would argue that it takes until Adam and Eve are created in the image of God and then are given the choice in the garden and free will is introduced, that God preordains free will, so God sort of creates the problem of evil in some regards. Another answer is that evil has nothing to do with God. It's a human invention, meaning it's this Yetzer Hara, the inclination to do evil, is front-loaded into our souls, front-loaded into our spirits, and it is that God within us that is constantly fighting and in conflict with that inclination to do evil. Right? If Adam and Eve stayed in the garden, we wouldn't be here. Right? What's the first thing that happens in chapter 4 of Genesis when they get expelled? She conceives and bears a kid. Now, I'm not talking about that from the more Christian viewpoint of original sin, but I want to say that idea does exist in Judaism. Not that sex is sinful, but that sex, intimacy, physical intimacy, romance, the feelings that, the urges, it's not to say that they're not created by God. Of course they're created by God, because God tells us to be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. That they aren't a function of sin, but they're a function of awareness. They're a function of awareness of what I would call emotion. And they are a function of the human ability to either balance or not balance, if done properly, tiferet, to create that tiferet. And that, for the Zohar especially, that physical intimacy is key, right? This is all symbolic of sex, of romance, of intimacy. As a function of free will, or as a product of getting kicked out of the garden and having free will, evil is introduced. But let's be honest, the temptation is there in the garden too. So temptation isn't sinful, but whether it's an unintended consequence or an intended consequence, I don't know, it can lead to evil. Temptation, human urge, human nature, whatever you want to call it, can lead to evil because ultimately we choose. What? It's taking your temptation seriously. Yes, it is like, oh, I'm tempted to kill this person, and then doing it. It's also, I believe, by the way, back to the text, like, why didn't Korach just pause for a second and realize he had a responsibility to his tribe, he had a responsibility to his family, and he had a responsibility to his name? Because think about how we talk about Korach now, 4,000 years later. Why didn't he just pause and think? Because the evil had consumed him. It goes back to this really hard truth, which is there is evil, and it exists. And there's nothing you can do about it when it's in relationship. Coming to that understanding is very, very hard for Moses. Okay, Lori, you're jumping out of your chair. And then we're gonna have to take a break because I'm the one who has to pee.
Everything in polarities. Everything.
Everything is created in polarities.
God has created everything in polarities, and it was built into the system of God. Like evil.
Uh-huh.
If it was God, God knew what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. It's God. Mm-hmm. He knew what was going to happen. And I think that he did it to give them the choice.
Mm-hmm.
He knew what was going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so going back to the idea is that God built into the system not just that there would be these choices of evil or good, but that actually the decisions were actually preordained too, I guess, and to some regard, because God set it up that way, right? Or organized it that way. Or knows what's going to happen. When God looks at Abel and says, Abel, right? Cain's thing gets accepted, Abel's rejected, and Cain is sitting there. I'm sorry, when God speaks to Cain, Abel's offering is accepted, Cain's is not, he's rejected, his face goes black. God says, Abel, I understand, I'm going to paraphrase. I wrote my thesis on this, it's really the only thing I know anything about. Cain, I understand you're mad. I understand you're furious. I understand you feel rejected, and I understand that you're filled with rage. Sin couches at your door. To you will it be its urge. Don't go there. So God, preordained or not, we don't know, says to Cain, I know you are so angry right now. The temptation to kill Abel, your brother, is within you. That is your human nature. I get it. Don't go there. And he goes there. Now, whether God knew that or not, preordained it or not, almost doesn't become important anymore. Because what becomes important is how God's talking to you. And you're basically saying, because you're Cain, you're basically saying, I'm going to ignore you and do what I want. That's how powerful evil is. Evil does not trump God. Let's make that clear. It doesn't. It does not lord over. It's not like that in Judaism. But it exists, and for us, because we're the vessels of it, it can be incredibly powerful. So powerful that something that we otherwise wouldn't do, we do. And that's what's going to happen in the next part of our Zohar about conflict. And then we are going to have to save at least 10 minutes at the end, 15 minutes, to talk about the conflict that is the machloket, that is for the sake of heaven, and what the difference is. Because one of the things that we'll learn is Korach's rebellion, conflict, arguing, whatever, is all about power. It is all evil and manipulation and power, and that he's a popular kid, but he's the kid who, when he doesn't get his way and doesn't have the punchline, doesn't get to write the story, loses it. And when we think about it, the image of the mouth of the earth opens up and swallows him, and think about hell, right? He goes to hell. Because God, in that moment, said, enough! But Moses has to go through a lot of pain in order to get there, you know? What does Cain say to God? Am I my brother's keeper? Yes, stupid, you are. I mean, that's what God, yeah, you are, but God has to come to the realization that Cain will never get it. And we're all from Cain. All right, break. Now that we've set up the analogy, let's apply it to the story. So Moses, the Zohar says, similar to this thing about day one, day two, day three, and this conflict and the resolution in day three, the quarrel of Korach with Aaron, he's saying that the fight was with Aaron. What do we know about Aaron as opposed to Moshe when it comes to rebellions? Think the golden calf. What? From the actual Torah, what do we know about Aaron? Wait. Someone else is answering. Did I say shout out the answers? No. I called on the person who raised their hand. I love you. Go.
He wasn't such a believer in the beginning, the golden calf.
He allowed it to happen, right? He was a man of peace, the rabbis say. He wanted to keep the peace. He didn't want them. He thought, if I let the golden calf builders lose control or take control and riot, there's going to be dead people. I'm going to be dealing with dead people. They're going to kill each other. So I'm going to let it happen and deal with the consequences later. The rabbis teach us that during the 40 years in the desert, more babies were named Aaron than anyone else, than Moses, than Korach, then Nadav, then Avihu, then Eleazar, then Nachshon. They were called, most boys were called Aaron because he was a man of peace. He was a leva, not a fighter. Now, in the Zohar, Aaron actually is described in terms of Givurah, in terms of judgment. But in the story that we're looking at here, the fight was between Korach and Aaron, okay? Was, it says, an antagonism of the left, Givurah, against the right, Chesed. An antagonism means they were being driven apart instead of brought together. That's going to be the key fundamental feature in the difference between machloket and arguing where there's evil versus good. Arguing for the sake of arguing, as I said, for Korach on his own behalf versus on behalf of God. Moses, reflecting on what had happened during the creation, says, "It seems proper to me to compose the difference between the right and the left." He wanted to understand, and we talked about this last time, what the difference between Givurah and Chesed really was. Right, he's trying to understand what the difference in these concepts are. Think about it in terms of you're sitting in shul on Yom Kippur. You're trying to figure out, because it's a very mixed message that we get from the prayers themselves on Yom Kippur, is God sitting in the kiseh, the seat of chesed, of compassion, or is God right at this moment, as I say this prayer, sitting in the seat of judgment? Who will live, who will die, who by storm, who by fire. Unatanatokov is a perfect example of that. And when we, those of you who attended the High Holiday Workshop, when we discussed the Zohar's interpretation of fear of God as opposed to awe of God, that became very apparent to us, that we shouldn't just see God in the seat of judgment on Yom Kippur on the Day of Judgment, but that we have to see God in both the seat of compassion and the seat of judgment. It is sort of parenting 101. When you as a parent can be in the seat of compassion and the seat of judgment simultaneously, it's not that your kids will love you anymore at any particular moment, but if it's what differentiates good parenting from bad parenting. And if I may be so bold to define bad parenting in terms of this, bad parenting is a parent who is all chesed, or a parent who is all Givurah. So all chesed means your kids can do no wrong, they are perfect, there is no discipline. It's what parents, not predominantly, but what a lot of parents do today. The kid is always right. As opposed to the parent who is just Givurah, that is, they're strict for no other reason than to exert power and authority over their kids. And these are, you know, I had very strict parents growing up, but I had very strict parents who were never afraid to tell me how much they loved me, how proud they were of me, to be physical, you know, affection-wise with me. There was a balance. But Moses is, in this verse, he says again, "It seems proper to me to compose the difference between compassion and judgment." That's what I think is our, actually, is our greatest challenge during Yom Kippur. It's also our greatest challenge as parents. I really think that for myself, yes. "He therefore endeavored to effect an accord between the two." Remember what we said about Moses. He realizes there's nothing he can do about this. So he tries one last thing. He tries to mediate it, right? Before he gets to the point where he realizes this is, I kind of gave you the punchline, the spoiler alert, when I talked about he realizes he can't change anything. I should have waited until, but I couldn't. I got off the beam, I got very excited. I gave you the spoiler alert, I gave you the punchline. But he's gonna now try to mediate these two. Because he really wants, his intention is for Tiferet. His intention is to bring the God into it, right? To balance the two. So he tries to mediate. If you look at the story of Korach, and I would of course encourage you to go take out your Bibles and look at the story of Korach in the book of Numbers. He therefore endeavored to effect an accord between the two. And I'm trying to look for that because I wanted to... Okay, I was going to show off and read some Aramaic, but I lost my spot. The left, however, was not willing, and Korach proved stubborn. And that was the Aramaic word I was going to use, because stubborn is not a good, exact, strong enough translation. Right? You can still move stubborn people. You can still move them. This is like stuck. And by the way, we know this about people who are bad and evil. They're stuck. They can't move. They're never going to change. Right? If anything, they'll get worse, not better. They don't change. So he's trying to create a compromise or mediate the two, and he realizes that Korach was on this left, this Gevura, which represents stubborn in this little analogy, right? Gevura means strong. So let's look at it as strong-willed, but not just strong-willed, unbreakable, unmovable. And Korach proved stubborn. Moses thereupon said, surely or assuredly, hell is embittering this quarrel. Now we can start to see this. Now, I mean, you know, think about how topsy-turvy, upside down the world is today. This is what's happening in our world. You've got a side that will not move. I had a very interesting conversation today. The Consul General of the LA Consulate of Azerbaijan was in town to meet with state legislators. This is part of his territory. And I had emailed him a while ago and said, whenever you're in town, I'd love to meet you. Azerbaijan is a huge supporter of Israel. It's really the only Muslim country. I mean, you know, Turkey's got a relationship with Israel, and Egypt has a relationship with Israel, and Jordan has a relationship. Azerbaijan is a friend of Israel. Okay, so 95% Muslim. I don't know, but he told me about how in Azerbaijan, Shia and Sunni marry each other openly, and there's no problems with it. And there's a mosque in Doha, which is the capital, that alternates services. One, what their Shabbat is Friday. So once every other week, the Sunni imam does the service. And every other week, the Shia imam does the service, but they pray together. So this Azerbaijan thing sounds pretty cool, right? So I found out about him in Azerbaijan through a friend, but also through Rabbi David Wolpe and some LA rabbis who have led missions to Azerbaijan, like they go to Israel. It's only 2.5 hours away flight time. And I thought, yeah, this makes sense with what we're talking about. If a Shia imam and a Sunni imam every other week can do services in the same mosque, that's Tiferet, right? That's like, oh my God, that's more than compromise. That's like, cool. They're open to it, right? But the person who is all Gevura, who's stuck, they're not open to anything other than what they want to be open to. So he recognizes this, that the hell is embittering the quarrel. Of course hell would embitter the quarrel. The left ought to strive upward. Right? We talked about this before. Instead of moving on, it should move up and absorb itself in the right. That's the narrative I was hearing today in this very quick meeting with this guy. And I thought, cool, we'll do an Israel trip and then we'll go to Azerbaijan because it sounds like we'll get like really first-class treatment. And I thought this, and they don't just sit with Israel. They do commerce and they have a synagogue in Doha and it's beautiful. Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, so, and this guy was very nice. And it's so funny, I said to him, this is when I feel, here I am, you know, Steve Kahn the Jew with, his name is Nassimi, the Muslim, And like, I feel like we're brothers. Like, I really feel like this is the way it ought to be. And he said the same thing. Like, this is why he's had really great relationships, closer relationships with the rabbis in the LA area. And then I also realized I'm the only rabbi that he met with today in Phoenix, or that he's ever met in Phoenix. And you know why? Because I called him, because I emailed him, because I was interested in hearing what the deal is with these people. And these people are us people too, as it turns out. It was very cool. P.S., just as a side note, this is very interesting. I said, so what are you doing about the import-export business of terrorism? Like, what distinguishes you from other Arab countries, other Muslim countries, when it comes to the import-export, the influencing of people to do bad, both within your society and import as far as they come in from other... Clergy, imams, are allowed... No clergy, Muslim, Christian, or Jewish, are allowed to get their education to become clergy outside of Azerbaijan and come back and practice as clergy. No, Jews are. That's the Jews are. Christians and Muslims are not. And no clergy trained from outside are allowed to be practicing clergy in Azerbaijan. It's a new law. And it sounds a little bit like that wouldn't fly in the United States. Because, you know, it violates all kinds of constitutional principles that we have. But I thought that was interesting. So basically, when someone tries to come in, oh, that's why he was here. The state of Arizona recognized the 25th commemoration of some basically terrorist attack in Doha or in part of Azerbaijan where 600 people were killed. And the Arizona legislature, commemorated that and presented him with the bill that they passed in support of Azerbaijan. You know, just when you think they're not doing anything there, they're doing some nice things. All right. The reason why, let's keep going here. Oh, let him then descend below in the impetus of his wrath. So now Moses has come to terms with the fact that he can't do anything about this evil. It's not going to move. It's not going to get fixed. He obviously has some feelings about this that are strong, and that's when God intercedes. So sort of like when all other hope fails, when Moses comes to the decision, whether it's about Aaron's leadership or his leadership, now God takes it personally, intervenes, and opens up the mouth of the earth, and down he goes. But Moses has to experience this rebellion in order for God to intervene. And so when it says in the Zohar, let him then descend below in the impetus of his wrath, it means let Korach now get sucked into the bottom of the earth, into the earth will open up and suck him in, and he can just sort of stew in his evil for eternity. So, because it's not going to get better. If Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, our rabbi, cannot do the intervention and be successful, no one can. So God then steps in. And that's when, if we want, I don't want to use this as a predictor of anything, but God will eventually step in, is what this teaches us too. Off the text, it's not in there. That's my belief, that will ultimately happen because Tiferet will ultimately prevail. Yeah?
Didn't God take him and his whole family and the whole tribe and everything? Wasn't just...
Yeah, there was hundreds of them that went with him.
So there was innocents that were also taken.
Hopefully this will come up when we do evil in the Zohar. There is a principle, an idea, if you will, in Judaism. There's only one way to defeat evil. You have to destroy all of it. That's why everyone went down with them. Dotan, Abiram, all of them. They had to destroy everything. You had to take them all out. Correct. Because you don't want... you know, the revenge factor to kick in for the next generation. And look at how that's turned out, you know, for us. Seriously, I mean, look at that. You know, we go and we partially remove cancers from the world. We, the United States, we partially remove cancers. And we leave just enough around so that they have children and grandchildren. And revenge is very much part of the culture.
Israel does the same thing.
Of course. Because we have to be careful. By the way, this is a great ethical conversation for another time. The reason why Korach refused to allow the quarrel to be composed by the intervention of Moses was that he had not entered upon it for a truly religious motive, and that he had scant regard for the glory of God and refused to acknowledge God's creative power. What the Zohar is doing now to help us is we've already taken it apart. We're trying to understand how Tiferet got removed and Hell took its place. We're trying to understand the nature of Korach's argument. Now they're really dissecting for us what was wrong, how a rebellion or a questioning of authority or a... I just asked that rhetorical question. You know, if Moses can't intervene and be successful, no one can. But why? What was really fundamentally wrong with Korach? Everything that I've said about Korach being evil, I've said. The text hasn't said it yet, but I know where the text is going. The reason why Korach refused to allow the choral to be composed by the intervention of Moses, the reason why Korach didn't allow for mediation, didn't allow for negotiation, didn't allow for Moses to be Moses, the teacher, rabbi, friend, leader, was because he had not entered upon it for a religious motive. What does that mean? He didn't enter into it for a religious motive. Because it wasn't for the sake of heaven.
What was that word?
Machloket. The argument, the dispute, the conflict was not for the sake of heaven. They go further. He had scant regard for the glory of God. Moses was assigned for this role by
God.
Moses tried to get out of this role. He said to God, I can't speak. They won't listen to me. The Pharaoh won't listen to me. I stutter. God said, I don't care. Now, Moses is allowed to argue with God, right? Yeah, Lori? That's different. So the question is, I'm not going to just say that's different and leave it there, but the question is that sort of in, and it doesn't have to be contemporary. It can be in the Torah too. If someone is not trying to promote the greater good, the will of God, the intention of goodness and the intention of love and peace and all those things, is that kind of what they mean by a religious motive? Is that kind of the question? Yeah. So, and when I say it's different, I want to tell you that the guys who are writing the Zohar have so much, we talked about this 2 weeks ago, have so much knowledge and access to text that they are, to an extent, without agenda, and that they're able to they have enough knowledge base to determine what is a religious motive and what is not. Now, fundamentally for them, a non-religious motive is someone who rises up and questions the authority of God himself or herself. That's what Korach does. It has nothing to do with Aaron, nothing to do with Moses. He's actually, forget about the greater good, he's actually, just for a second, questioning God's authority, not Moses's, right? That's the problem with Korach. It doesn't matter because God already made the choice. You know what I mean? Yeah, of course he was jealous. I mean, that's implied in the text itself. And we've talked about that at Torah study before, sort of like, what did he do that was so wrong? Well, he did it, and then he kept doing it. Even though someone who doesn't fear God in that sense can't understand Tiferet. Someone who doesn't understand that this was God's choice. Now, in modern, contemporary, cultural, societal, our problem, one of our fundamental problems is we haven't decided what the greater good is yet. I don't believe we have decided what the greater good is yet. The division between, it's funny, the division between right and left, right? It's right here. Has everything to do with the all or nothing approach on both sides. The all or nothing. I am absolutely right. You are absolutely wrong. There's no negotiation. And guess what happens? That entire energy that we feel of the Yiddish expression, pumfakert, that it's upside down, that everything has been turned over. Going back to the story of creation, by the way, the word havdalah or mavdil is used twice. God has to separate those things in order for them to go back together. I know that doesn't make complete sense, but go into your Kabbalistic minds for a second. Yes, we have to be where we are now, politically, societally, everywhere. Let me just explain it this way, in order for it to come back together at some point, because when it comes back together stronger. That's the idea. And that's our hope, right? And that's what that expression has to get worse before it gets better means. It's sort of like the tearing apart, the tearing apart, the tearing apart. It's not till day three. Let's put the pieces back together. And when they come together, it's stronger. Right? So, for those who have experienced natural disasters before, you probably have seen this happen. I was in UC Santa Cruz in 1989 for the Loma Prieta earthquake. And were you guys in Northern California? So Loma Prieta was 10 miles away from Santa Cruz, but the damage, the real damage in San Francisco and on the freeway, that was because of the shock waves from the earthquake, and depending on where you were. Watching a city literally tear apart, there were places in Santa Cruz when the streets were, you know, 5 feet difference between the road and then whatever happened up here, you know, when the road went up and buckled. And there were these moments where everyone came together and there was healing and there was this incredible transcendent sort of feeling of togetherness and peace. That's kind of what happens. Things tear apart and eventually, it's not immediate gratification, my friends. You still have to rebuild the city, put the freeway back together, fix the bridge. But there are those moments of transcendent healing that take place. That doesn't happen in this story. By the way, a machloket, a fight for the sake of heaven, you go at it. There is creative tension. There is a beautiful creative process that comes from friction. That's what makes it for the sake of heaven. So when Rabbi Keller and I get into a brawl over anything, right? We've been together now a long time. And it's not about senior rabbi, associate rabbi anymore. He's been a rabbi here. I've been a rabbi here. We both are rabbis. We're past the whole hierarchy, although I still. It is for the sake of heaven. How do I know? Because every Friday night on the Bima, every Shabbat, what you see as far as the synergy and the fun and the banter is authentic. And part of that authenticity comes from the fact that we have arguments, right? So I think it's like when you say to a couple who are getting married, how do you guys fight? You know, it's about that. It's about not tearing down totally. And that's what the firm, okay, I have to get through this. When Moses perceived, I'm skipping, that he had thus placed himself outside the pale, what's his name, Korach, he was very angry. That's in the text. That's in Numbers. If you want to go home and you want to read chapter 17 of Numbers, you can read the actual story. And then the Zohar has fun with it. Because they say, why does it never says in the Torah that you were very something. It just says he was angry. Like, there's an expression in the Torah, mot yumat, which means surely dead. Mot, which means dead or death. Why is it repeated twice? And as my father would say, mot yumat means a deadly dead death. There is some emphasis when it says very angry that the Zohar is going to have fun with. He was angry because he wasn't able to compose the choral, which means he wasn't able to bring the Tiferet in. He was very angry because they denied the creative power of God. That is the antithesis of the machloket, of the argument for the sake of heaven. In relationships, arguments are fundamental. But arguments that, or let's just keep calling it conflict, that is antithetical of for the sake of heaven, the antithesis of that. He was very angry, it says, because they denied the creative power of God. The creative power of God comes from day one and day two being reconciled by day three. The creative tension, the friction that brings about a closeness that is transcendent, that is a higher level, that's where Tiferet comes in, and we can move up the chart of bringing God back together. Korach denied this power wholly, fully, both in the higher and in the lower sphere, as implied with the phrase, when they strove against God. Hence, Korach cleaved to that which was fitting for him. A conflict that is a bad conflict that comes from a place of evil is a conflict whereby the only thing you're interested in fighting for and about is yourself. Period. There is no negotiation, there is no movement, there is no Tiferet ever. And so God opens the mouth of the earth and bye-bye Korach. Now, We want to see an amicable conflict, and I only have 7 minutes left. We're going to go back now to a second for Hillel and Shammai. Okay, so the machloket that Hillel and Shammai present us is they argued and disputed and were in conflict about everything. These are our typical two Jews, three arguments, right? They argued about which way to put the most famous, to put the Hanukkah candles in. Do we start at 8 or do we start at 1? That's the kind of stuff they argued about. All machlokets, all for the sake of heaven. Here's what the Zohar says. And this is how, by the way, we'll bring these two together and bring about Tiferet and love. Because at the end of an argument, the implication is they loved each other more. It is the way of the righteous to enter on a dispute stiffly and end it amicably. If you ever read the beginning of an argument in the Talmud, they go after each other. They call each other the Aramaic equivalent of stupid, pig-headed, stubborn, idiotic, you've got to be kidding me. There are certain words in Aramaic in the Talmud that can only be translated. There's a word, etmaha, which is Aramaic for, you have to be kidding me. Okay? And that's exactly how my professor taught it to me. And you have to be kidding me. Etmaha. He said the best way to translate etmaha is to put all the different things on the top of the letter, the numbers on the typewriter, on the keyboard, and put that in there. It's all dirty, right? And so it starts out bad and fierce and sort of strong, but it ends amicably. It's a good fight. Korach continued the dispute as he began it. What does that mean? He had no intention of resolving it. His way or the highway was the only way. He had no intention of resolving it. Whereas the intention of a rabbi, Rabbi Keller, Rabbi Kahn, Rabbi Hillel, Rabbi Shammai, is for the sake of heaven, for God to win out. Yay, right? But Korach continued the dispute before he even started it, or as he was starting it. And therefore, he clung to hell, right? He had no other place to go. Shammai conducted his dispute in that spirit of calm, which should follow on the first burst of passion. It therefore became a quarrel of love and obtained the approval of heaven. And this is indicated by our text. It says, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters and let it divide. Now, you're going to understand why I kept referring to the third day being the reconciliation between the first two, I hope. This refers to the beginning of a quarrel and the outburst of passion and violence. There was a desire for reconciliation, but meanwhile, the Gehinnom arose before the wrath and passion cooled down. Then God made the firmament. That is, there emerged a quarrel of love and affection which made for the permanence of the world, right? You can't have permanence of the world without firmament. No permanence without firmament, without land, without water. You can't just float around in water all the time, above and below. You need land. You need somewhere to sit. And that water has to be contained somewhere. That's why you have an ocean. It can't just be passion and crazy, right? So Gehinnom arose before it was, okay, God made the firmament. That is, there emerged a quarrel of love and affection which made for the permanence of the world. In this category is the dispute between Shammai and Hillel. By the way, we talked about this last week, things have to get very messy before we can get to Tiferet. You have to explain. You have to experience the pain, the suffering, the arguing, the fighting, the breaking apart, and the chesed, the love and the compassion, the will of peace and all that good yummy stuff, in order for the bring them together and you have Tiferet. Hillel and Shammai, the dispute between Shammai and Hillel, the result of which was that the oral law, right, that is the stuff given to Moses at Sinai that was the Talmud and the commentaries and all that, the oral law approached in a loving mood the written law so that they mutually supported each other. There is a tradition within the tradition where the rabbis really want to trump over the written law. In other words, they want to say, it doesn't matter what that silly Moses said in the Torah. What we say is more authoritative. And yet, in that process, what they do is they bring together, by the way, this is when we start to get into Keter and the higher levels. I'm keeping it low for now. Low, it's still high. But I'm keeping it in the middle for now because I really want us to understand the nature of it's building up, nature of good and evil and all that stuff, and Tiferet, because I think Tiferet is going to be our way out of conflict. But in order to get to Tiferet, we have to really understand the difference between, as Lori put it, the greater good and our own sort of selfish inability to see the greater good because we're so stuck in ourselves. And that's Lori, that's why I said it's different. It's different because the greater good for someone who's really got bad intentions, right? We have to accept the idea that ISIS thinks that what they're doing is for the greater good. Even though it's Narishkeit, and even though it's not even close to what the intention is. The intention has to do with Korach's intentions. Power, undermining of heavenly authority, and undermining of the fact that we are not God. And when someone starts to think that they're God and they take it very seriously, we're in a lot of trouble, those of us who are kind of good, mostly good-hearted people. Because we can get eaten up by them. We can get consumed by the hellfire too, by the way. It creeps up. It's our job to bring them closer together so that it gets subdued. So if you're feeling that hellacious energy in the world right now, it's because it's there. It's not the first time. It's not the last time. And as I said, it's our job to subdue it. And part of subduing it, if we go back to this, because this is all about the Torah coming together, right? The oral law and the written law. It's a great, it's the antithetical example of how, for the sake of heaven, an argument, bringing everything back together, can be this sort of representation of God on earth instead of hell on earth, through Tiferet, through arguing, and through. So here's the assignment. The assignment is, how do you handle conflict? And at what point, by the way, in order to do the machloket, in order to do the argument for the sake to heaven, you have to really know both sides. You have to understand both sides. So what the rabbis do is they look, and both sides for them in this scenario means the oral law and the written law, because sometimes they are definitely at odds. And I told you the argument starts up with, are you kidding me? Right? Oftentimes. But look at that first sentence again. Enter the dispute stiffly, end it amicably. Whereas Korach starts the dispute stiffly and keeps doing it stiffly. And at what point in a conflict, I have to do this too, we all do this, do you just say to someone, we probably shouldn't talk about this anymore? We know this, by the way, like, I'm not going to be able to engage in this conversation because you didn't go from stiffly to amicably or anywhere near it. You went from stiffly to just being a jerk and saying things that aren't very nice at all. And at what point does it get even more evil than that? So it's very easy to take that seriously, and it's very hard to do what Moses did. I mean, Moses really had to get to that place of saying to himself, Korach has no wish to attach himself to the higher influences and to merge himself in the right. Let him then descend below in the impetus of his wrath to say, as good a man as I am, as Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses our teacher, and as amicable as I want this to be, and as hard as it is to lead all these people, as good as I want this to turn out, and as good as my intentions are, there is no way of solving this and dealing with him amicably or peacefully. So let the dice, you know, let it fall, let it happen, and because of it, it's like we've all had this experience before. Sometimes you have to get rid of that toxic person in your life, right? You just have to cut them off. And I'm sorry if it's our brother or our sister, God forbid our parent, God forbid our kid, right? Let's start with the real stuff, right? Let's forget about friends. Sometimes we just have to let them go. There's nothing we can do about it. They are beyond the pale. And that is so hard. And I don't want to end there. I want to end with this. conflict for the sake of heaven, arguing for the machloket for the sake of God, for the sake of heaven. Really, when we enter, this is the other side of it, a conflict with the intention of walking away closer, of walking away, having learned something, being open to that at least, we really do, in a very powerful way, deny hell from entering into the equation and entering into our force, into our energy field, if you will, into our world. And that's the only, watch what happens. It's going to get worse before it gets better. The more stubborn, and then the more, I was watching some of these town hall meetings and fights, and I don't know if you saw the clip of the 8-year-old with the senator, and he was talking about, I just want to watch PBS Kids. And the senator started to talk about drug cartels, and it's like, oh my God, from the mouth of an 8-year-old, right? I just want to watch PBS Kids. PBS Kids is cartoons on PBS, these great, wonderful educational cartoons that all of our kids grew up on, and I grew up on Sesame Street and so on and so forth. And the poor senator, God bless him, just didn't understand it at all and started going on this rant about drug cartels with the 8-year-old. And it's going to get worse before it gets better. We have to get on the same page. It's the only way of living. But he realizes that. And the machloket at the end, they don't even tell us what the argument was in here, by the way, between Shammai and Hillel. They just say, as a representation of all arguing, because that's all they did, was argue about stupid things, like how many candles to start with or end with. Silly things, not stupid things, silly things. That's for the sake of heaven. Why? Because it approaches the other in a loving mood. So that they mutually support each other. Your argument should mutually support someone else's, which means I'm not absolutely right, you're not absolutely right, but I'm not absolutely wrong and you're not absolutely wrong. That's where the love is. That's where the tiferet is. And so let's take that message away from tonight and come back next week, and we'll have another text to get all into and have a good time. Thank you all for listening and participating.